In this video, I'm going to give you three reasons of why you should learn Chinese if you don't already speak it. Hi, you're watching AvenueX, where a junkie on good storytelling shares her thoughts, knowledge, and occasional weird ideas on stories and how they're told. But today's video is not about story, it's not about drama review, it's about something that I've been wanting to share with you and talk to people who watch my channels for a while. And the topic is why you should learn Chinese. I know everyone's time is precious, so I'm going to go straight to the point. I have three main reasons that I can think of as of why, if you don't speak Chinese, if Chinese is a language that is foreign to you, you really, really should pick it up. The first reason is a very general reason that I think it applies to learning any other foreign language that is very different from your mother tongue. That is, it opens up a different way of looking at the world. Because Chinese language is so unique in many ways, there really isn't a similar or equivalent language elsewhere in the world. Of course, you can argue that all languages in the world are very different and distinctive, but there are languages that are very closely related. For example, a lot of European languages are from very similar roots. So they share a lot of grammatical structures, they share vocabulary, and because of the culture is so closely related, when you speak them, you're kind of using the same kind of part of your brain to process or the similar perspective of looking at the world. If you're watching this video, most likely you are fluent in English. As humans, once we learn a language, we really use it for everything. It's not just for daily communication. And the language we speak in turn shapes our perspective of the world. I can tell you from my experience that the way English language looks at the world is very, very different from the way Chinese language looks at the world. And why is gaining extra perspective important? I think especially in this day and age, when the world is getting smaller because we have internet, we have such easy access to information, there's more and more communication and things happening because people can so easily come together. Everyone will inevitably encounter more foreign things, things that are different from the things that we're used to as we grew up, from our home city, from our own circle. There will be more and more things from outside that we have to deal with and we need to deal with. So having only one perspective of looking at the world really isn't that beneficial to anyone who lives in this day and age. And knowing an extra language really can help you see things in a different way. It's still the same thing, same people, same events, but then using another language, you almost get a second perspective. The more perspectives you can have, the more complete your understanding of the world around you can be, and it will give you advantages and serve you in ways that you couldn't imagine had you not known that language or that perspective. But based on my personal experience, I would say I would never ever regret learning English to the point that I can use it as fluently as Chinese. It really has given me a lot of advantages, and it has helped me open my eyes to a lot of information, a lot of knowledge, another way of experience your life that you would never have if you hadn't learned the English language. So if your mother tongue, the language that you speak most, is very different from Chinese, then you can benefit a lot from learning it. That being my first reason. My second reason is probably the most important reason, and it's gonna take a bit of time for me to explain. This is a very pragmatic way of looking at this problem and why I think learning Chinese is a really good idea for people who don't speak Chinese in this day of age. It is not my personal opinion, it is based on a lot of data and a lot of statistics that in the next 10, 20, 30 years, the world is going to see the rise of the East Asian region. The world has been dominated by the West, namely the US and the European countries, for about 200 years. And that era is slowly but surely coming to an end. And leading this change, this gradual decline of the Western world and the rise of the Eastern world, is going to be led by China. as it has been developing at a phenomenal speed that human civilization really has never seen before for the past 30 years, and it's still heading towards the direction of slowing down but still developing quite fast. And one thing China does have is its huge population. As I mostly now live in the West, but I do go back to China, and whenever I'm away from China for a while, say for a year or so, you go back and you get shocked by how fast things are changing and happening. It's not just about building new buildings and roads, which of course is happening very fast in China as well, but it is about how technology and innovative new things affect people's daily life. If you live in a metropolis area in China these days, you're likely to have a much more convenient, much more well-developed technology-wise life than really anywhere else in the world. The ease of paying money, of receiving your delivery parcels, is just so much better right now in China. So that means China has a huge domestic demand of everything, and because of that, new things and new innovations and new entrepreneurship and new opportunities of creating your own business and making something and that nobody has ever made before are concentrated in China, in East Asia. If you are watching my video, you're probably between 25 to 34. That's the largest demographic I have, but then in your early 20s to your 40s probably. And if you are thinking about what you want to do in this world for the next 20 years, 30 years, what kind of new things you might be able to create, and what kind of new opportunities that you can get, or you can invent, or you might benefit in this really fast developing and changing world, the chances are a lot of potential opportunities lies in the East. And due to a lot of political, cultural, economic reasons, among those two big countries, China would be the one to lead this wave of shift of global power. I'm not saying this because I'm Chinese and I'm trying to, you know, make China look better than it is. China has a lot of problems, but the thing is, the trend is going in that direction, and the will of history is really, really very impartial to anyone involved. What's gotta happen, gotta happen, and no personal effort is going to stop that big historical wave and trend. So the cleverest thing anyone can do is being able to recognize where things are moving and being able to take the advantage and be the first or be the early ones to recognize this change and do something about it. To invest in something that may benefit you in the next 10, 20, 30 years of your life. Looking at language, for example, English, why it has become the dominant language in the world today, it is because mostly it's being backed. It has a patron, language patron, that is the US in our time. But before that, that's the British Empire. Because of their military, political, economic dominance over the world, the language itself becomes dominant. And everything that's tied in with language, like culture, film industry, entertainment, we can see how dominant that becomes. I mean, if you go out and look at how many Blu-ray DVDs are out there, mostly, you know, globally, mostly they're in English because that's the dominant language. Now, this is going to slowly but surely shift, because if the US power, economic-wise, as we know that China's GDP is growing, and within very short period of time from now on, we're gonna see it taking over US. As that happens, the language, the culture thing is going to catch up. Now, it may not happen immediately. It may take 2 decades, 3 decades to happen, but we will see Chinese language become more and more important to everyone involved in this globalization age. Whether you're doing business, whether you're doing cultural communication, whatever you're doing, this language is going to come across, it's going to show up in your life more and more. And the earlier you learn it, and the earlier you master it, you have an earlier advantage over everyone who doesn't. It's a very simple thing. If you are chasing new opportunities and you're recognizing this trend, then learning Chinese is a very good investment. It is taking probably a couple of years of your time to spend on regularly polishing your skills in this language, but it's going to benefit you for the rest of your life. The thing with Chinese language and culture is because it's so old and it has so much cultural baggage, as I call it, carried in this language. You really cannot understand how Chinese people think or how the Chinese society work, how it functions without knowing the language in depth. So you cannot rely on translation, you cannot rely on other people helping you. If you're really interested in the rise of the East Asia, if you see opportunities that you want to pursue in that part of the world, or in communication of that part of the world, or in collaboration of that part of the world, learn Chinese. It is really, really useful and important and essential, and it's gonna benefit you. It's gonna benefit you for a long time to come. Now, if you have a preference of a language that you wanna learn, go ahead, learn the one that you really, really like and really, really want, because that's the one that you're gonna be able to stick with. But if you do have time, you have energy on your hand, you really wanna try and learn a new language, but you are kind of impartial to any language, and you happen to not know Chinese, then it is my sincere recommendation that you go pick Chinese up, because it's really, really very likely to serve you probably in the most sort of effective and best ways. So that is my second reason as of why you should learn Chinese. My third and last and most personal reason as of why you should learn Chinese is about the language itself. It's about being able to appreciate beauty that comes from linguistic pleasures. It's over 10, almost 15 years ago when you think about that, that I went to the UK to study, and my first degree was in English literature. So I studied English in the most English way. I studied novels, from Dickens, from the Bronte sisters. I studied short stories by contemporary American authors like Raymond Carver. I studied Shakespeare, I studied Wordsworth and Blake and all those romantic poets. During my years of studying English literature, I realized this huge difference, especially in poetry and in playwriting, that type of very concentrated, rhythmic, rhyming writing. The difference between English and Chinese is like heaven and earth. It's like ice and fire. It's completely different. So while people do attempt to translate Chinese poetry to English or vice versa, the translation never ever captures the original quality of the original language. The higher the level of literature, or when you think about if literature actually has levels, probably the bottom level would be like novel writing. Now, I don't mean to diss any people who practice in this art form, but when you look at literature globally, the development is always kind of coming from a top end, gradually developing more form of more commonly accepted literature. In that oldest day, in China, for example, poetry is the highest form of literature writing, and then you develop prose and you develop novel writing. It happens later in history. It's the same thing in English and in many countries' history. So the higher form of literature or of language beauty are usually appreciated in the form of poetry. Personally, I'm also very interested in poetry, in Chinese poetry as well. While I would never claim myself to be an expert in Chinese literature or English literature in any way, I do have a relatively good understanding of what kind of stuff are out there in both languages. It's very easy for me to remember poetry writing than prose writing. I can often look at a poem just for a few times and remember it, even though it's long. It's just very easy for me to understand what kind of picture a poem is trying to describe in the language. Now, because I know both languages and I compare their poetry, and I would say the amount of information, the amount of concept, idea, picture that Chinese poetry can paint for you when you read it is in many ways much richer than how English can perform or can give you. I don't mean disrespect of English as a language. I just mean when it comes to the art form of poetry. Chinese really has so many advantages over English as a language. It is just the nature of the language that dictates how it works. When it comes to Chinese poetry, you are not just writing for certain rhythm or certain rhyme. You have a much more rigid, much more well-crafted form that you have to fit in with writing poetry. Probably everyone has experienced that the hardest thing to write is not giving you a topic. It's not giving you a title. You just go ahead and write anything you like and you are lost. In that way, Chinese poetry has very strict, rigid forms and things that you have to fit your language into. But that also stimulates so much creativity. And in Chinese poetry, you also have to note not just rhyme or rhythm, you also have to note the tone. So how each character sounds and how each line sounds and how it compares to the second line. So it's almost musical. Even if you're not singing, the lyrics, the poems out, when you are just reading it, the sound becomes extremely important in Chinese poetry. Now that just doesn't exist in English poetry. And not to that kind of level. And also Chinese language is super, super condensed. Any books that you come across, if it has a Chinese version and it has an English translation, the English translation book is always a third to a fourth thicker than the Chinese version, being that the language itself is more condensed, so it puts more meaning into a smaller space. Because I appreciate literature a lot and I love poetry. So when I listen to a Chinese poem or read a Chinese poem, that kind of feeling, that kind of satisfaction that you can get from the language itself cannot be translated into English. It always gets lost. So I've had this feeling when I was studying English literature back in England, when I had this Chinese poem that I was trying to translate it to my professor or to my classmates. I just feel so sad because 50%, 60% of the beauty of the poetry got lost. It doesn't matter how good a translator I am, it just doesn't get translated. If you like beautiful things in your life, some people really, really do. Some people don't really care as long as something works. Some people are really particular about beauty. Some people really want to see what are the other possibilities out there in the world. What are the undiscovered beauties that exist that I'm not aware of that I really want to know? If you're one of those people, I highly recommend you. Study Chinese and study it to the level that you can understand ancient poetry, because that's where the most beautiful part of Chinese language, in my opinion, exists. And just for getting that beauty, understanding that beauty for that pleasure's sake, and it has to be discovered and experienced by yourself. Right now I'm only talking about the sound and meaning part, but if you look at the calligraphy, looking at the writing system, that's a whole different world. Chinese calligraphy. It's regarded as one of the highest form of art in Chinese traditional society. It's higher than painting. It's even higher than poetry in a way. Like if you can write the calligraphy beautifully, you're considered to be a well-learned scholar and you're respected just by being able to write beautifully. Because it is in itself a very intricate art form. You kind of need to know the language to appreciate why it is considered beautiful or why something is a masterpiece. Okay, so that ties up the three reasons I think why you should learn Chinese at this time, particular time of human history. People who have been watching my videos know that I've made videos asking about your suggestions about what type of videos I should make. And a lot of you did mention some cultural lessons, some lessons in Chinese language, so it is always at the back of my mind that it could be a potential series of videos. But if I do teach Chinese on my channel, I probably wouldn't do it in a normal way, because you can find a lot of Chinese teaching lessons on YouTube and they're very standard way of teaching language. So if I ever do that, I might do it differently. I would also love to hear your suggestions. If you are interested in seeing me do some Chinese lessons on my channel, what type of lessons are you thinking of? how you think that it might be more interesting to you or serve you better, please leave your suggestions in the comment below. Thank you for watching AvenueX. I'll see you in my next video. Meanwhile, live long and happy language learning.